This hour of Hugh Hewitt starts right now on Salem News Channel.
Good morning, America. I hope you have a great Friday ahead as we head into high summer. Dr. Larry Arnn at Hillsdale is coming along, hillsdale.edu, somewhere later in the program. We're going to be talking about the Supreme Court and everything that got done and didn't get done and will happen with SCOTUS, plus all the news of the day. Everything you need to know is right here on the Friday edition of The Hugh Hewitt Show.
Want to miss a minute. This hour of Hugh Hewitt is on Salem News Channel.
There's a reason that we live so far from Hollywood. In the country, looking hard to find a home. We're nothing perfect or considered, but we're so damn good. It's the story.
Morning, glory, America. Bonjour, hi, Canada. It's Hugh Hewitt. Mission Impossible 900 comes out today on this July 14th. And I don't know what to think about this because I'm on strike. Nobody told me, nobody took a vote, but SAG-AFTRA went out on strike last night. And I've been a member of SAG-AFTRA, the Screen Artists Guild, American Federation of Television and Radio Artists, since 1992, maybe 1991. So I'm a union member. And I will not be appearing in Mission Impossible 901 or Top Gun 3 unless they get this settled. Now, the radio show is not covered by SAG-AFTRA, so I can go to work, but I'm not doing any more big movies. Not doing that. Wouldn't be prudent. Not going to cross a picket line. So you have I'm standing with you, SAG-AFTRA members. Keep those pension benefits coming. Now, I've been a SAG-AFTRA member forever, so longer than some of the people on the picket line have been alive. So go SAG-AFTRA. Not sure what we struck over, and nobody asked me, but we did. I've got 50 more reasons never to talk to the Iranians. All right. Now, Israel released yesterday the story that it had foiled more than 50 attacks Iran had intended to carry out against Israeli and other Jews across the world in recent years. Defense Minister Gallant said in a visit to Azerbaijan yesterday. So I'm thinking to myself, why in the world do we do anything with them? Why would you want to be in the same room? They're all killers. Turns out John Kerry was on the Hill yesterday. The John Kerry, I served in Vietnam. John Kerry was on with Michael Waltz, a congressman, who pressed him on the fact that John Kerry not only dealt with the Iranians while he was President Biden's Secretary of State, he dealt with the Iranians when he was out of office, and he continues to deal with the Iranians. And that's illegal, by the way, conducting diplomacy in the name of the United States. And so Michael Waltz grilled him. Here's the congressman and John Kerry yesterday. This is cut number 9.
Would you find it appropriate if a former Trump administration official traveled around and talked to the same officials you are and said, you don't have to abide by these agreements, hold fast till 2024, a new regime or a new administration may be coming in, and therefore undermining current administration diplomacy? Would you find that appropriate?
I'm not going to speak to any hypotheticals, but I can tell you I never engaged in that.
Shadow diplomacy undermines American goals.
Shadow diplomacy, depending on what involved. Shadow diplomacy has also saved us from a war. If you look at 1963 with the Cuban missile crisis, it was behind the scenes, back
Mr. channel. Mr. Secretary, I would posture that your shadow diplomacy now has us on the verge.
I wasn't
of
conducting shadow diplomacy.
Weapon.
I was at a security conference.
That is now exploding as they race towards full enrichment from 20% to 60% on the verge of having a nuclear weapon and a nuclear arms race in the Middle East.
And the reason that has happened is that Donald
Americans,
Trump pulled out of the agreement.
We don't undermine other administrations.
The reason that happened, my friend, is because Donald Trump pulled out of that agreement. There was no way they could have had a nuclear weapon under the agreement that existed. And even in Israel, the security establishment of Israel believed that agreement had done the job. President Trump just pulled out.
Chair now recognizes Mr. Schneider.
You know, what's fascinating about that is John Kerry first says, I didn't do it. Then he says, we did it during the Cuban Missile Crisis in 1963. Wrong year, Mr. Kerry. And then he says it had nothing to do with the failure of the Iran deal. The point is, shadow diplomacy by non-officials destroys the ability of the United States to negotiate with foreign powers. John Kerry did that. Michael Waltz called him out on it, and that's good. But the Democrats have lost their mind on national security. The NDAA got through all the amendments last night. Ukraine aid is still in there. There were like 80 Republicans who voted against the package in whole or part. But now the NDAA comes to the floor, and I hope it will pass today. But Democrats, at least six Democrats, have told Josh Kroshaw, a frequent guest on this program, that they're going to be voting against the National Defense Authorization Act because of abortion and DEI. Because, not surprisingly, the Republicans banned the new abortion policy that Lloyd Austin cooked up out of nowhere, which we will pay for benefits for military uniformed personnel to fly somewhere to get an abortion. And that's being banned in the NDAA, and that's in the bill. And they banned DEI at the military academies and in training of the troops. And so Democrats would rather cripple the national defense than pass an NDAA that in any way limits abortion. Abortion matters more to them than a national defense. So if Democrats bring down this bill today and don't vote for this bill, it's not because they disagree with Ukrainian aid. It's because they want abortion on demand for everyone in the military. And Lloyd Austin invented that. So watch the NDAA. I'll check in a little bit later with that. The defense bill is the lead story today. It'll be passed by the time I'm on special report tonight or not, and we'll be able to copy it. Couple other big story. Deep-pocketed donors give fresh attention to Tim Scott's long-shot presidential bill. Tim Scott has $21 million in the bank now, and he's just living in Iowa. I think he's going to be bringing in the corn pretty soon. Senator Scott, I hope we get him on next week. Headline in the Wall Street Journal, if you find the economy confusing, don't worry. It is. Is it ever? I mean, yesterday I was just watching the market in amazement. I didn't know what's going on. It's artificial intelligence again, all right, combined with inflation not going away. This is brought to you by Birch Gold. If you're buying gold this weekend or today, do it at hughgold.com or text my name, Hugh, to 989898. The Dow was up 0.25%. The S&P was up 0.75%. The NASDAQ was up 1.15%. The 10-year Treasury dropped a little bit to 3.793, but gold went up to $1,691 an ounce. Hefty high. Not Amazon. Amazon went up 2.68%, or $3.50 a share yesterday, as artificial intelligence continues to power Microsoft, NVIDIA, Amazon. I think Amazon's the safest play if you want some AI in your portfolio, but you don't want to go haul hog on something that's a boomlet. And it is a boom. It's like the tulip boom. It's like the dot-com boom of the 90s. You got to be careful about whenever someone gets involved. But Amazon's got a slice of Amazon invested in AI. So if it's real, you get the benefits. But if you want just good old solid gold, go over to hughgold.com. $1,961 an ounce is the strike price today. Ask them to open up. Get the free information kit on how you get an IRA or a SEP IRA or a 401k going with them as a third-party intermediary. Get that done today. And let me go back now to more news. The leadership troubles in the Russian war. I posted this over on Twitter. My Twitter account is Hugh Hewitt. My Threat account is Hugh Hewitt 3, but I don't put much over there. Not really sold on that because I think I gave away all my data when I signed up for that. And I don't know if I can get it back, but I'm not sure if it. I only get... It's hard for me to figure out what the data mining is that's going on at Threat. So I'm staying away from it until I figure out what's going on over there. Twitter does not data mine my entire phone. I'm not sure I don't do Instagram either for that reason. I just don't like people knowing where I am or what I'm doing. And I think Threads does that. I'll find out. But the lead story in this morning's Twitter account by me is a piece from News Items. That's the Substack that John Ellis writes every morning. The last thing I read every morning. Hours after Russian paramilitary leader Yevgeny Prigozhin began a short-lived march on Moscow, the country's domestic security service detained several high-ranking military officers, including General Sergei Surovikin, head of the aerospace forces. People familiar with the situation said Surovikin, known as General Armageddon for bombing campaigns he waged in Syria, is being held and interrogated in Moscow, the people said. He hadn't been charged with a crime. They very rarely do in Stalinist countries. One said Surovikin knew about plans for the insurrection, but the general wasn't involved in the June 24th military. The Kremlin's effort to weed out officers has 13 senior officers behind bars, like Dwayne. Dwayne's going to be behind bars. He comes back, by the way, on Monday. Adam, how much weight do you think he's lost or gained for my PhD weightloss.com in a week of eating whatever is boiled in Tennessee?
He's probably pretty close to the line, maybe 5.
195? You think he's gone over 195?
It's possible. They have good meats out there, so.
He lost 50 pounds on MyPhDWeightLoss.com, and he kept it off, but then he went to Tennessee where they're roasting boar and deer in the backyard at Schroeder's house in their Roll Tide t-shirts. So I would encourage all of you to get over to MyPhDWeightLoss.com, 864-644-1900. 864-644-1900. We'll check in with Dwayne on Monday. I'll be on special report tonight, and I'll be looking svelte because I didn't have to lose 50 pounds. But Dwayne did, but I'm afraid Nashville food, Knoxville food may very well have pushed him over the red line back up to 45 or less. So we'll talk to him about that on Monday. You can go visit MyPhDWeightLoss.com right now and come right back to the Hugh Hewitt Show. Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. Lena Khan, who's the crazy left-wing head of the Federal Trade Commission, got hammered in hearings yesterday. I may have time to get to that in a little bit. But the FTC chair faces criticism in congressional hearing. That's not criticism. That's getting hammered. Meanwhile, Speaker McCarthy, who got the NDAA to the floor last night, despite the left hoping that it wouldn't get there, it'll be voted on today, and Democrats are going to have to decide whether they prefer the nation's defense to abortion, and they're going to vote for abortion instead of the nation's defense. Speaker McCarthy went on with Martha McCollum yesterday on Fox News, said this about Director Ray, cut number 12.
But I do want to ask you about something that you just touched on, because, you know, we heard from Christopher Ray yesterday, and his overall tone, I would say, is, look, we do an amazing job here at the FBI. And here was his response when he was asked about whether or not the Bidens do get any special treatment in these situations. Watch.
Are you protecting the Bidens?
Absolutely not.
Do you believe that? Do you agree with what Christopher Wray said? Do you think that he's credible with that answer, Speaker?
He's not credible with the answer. And I think his whole testimony shows the FBI is actually broken under his leadership. And I'm not talking about the rank and file agents who are doing their job every day. Mm-hmm. Thank you for the work you're doing. But the bureaucracy is broken. Because remember what Wray said even in his testimony here. He wouldn't answer questions. He didn't tell us why the FBI went after Catholics. He wouldn't apologize when the FBI went after parents. He wouldn't tell us or apologize for using companies to spy and their data to spy on average Americans. But what's even more importantly, when he knew he had a 1023, a person that he actually still pays to this day, an informant, that provided him information about the Biden Inc. family, he ignored it. And he didn't pass it on to the IRS that was looking into it. So no, he has not been equal justice. And so he does not have the trust of the American public. And that's bad because his agency is a great agency that has to protect America. And the bureaucracy now he's created has broken the system.
Well, if that's
now, it got worse yesterday because the FBI, the Secret Service and the FBI announced, we can't find who brought cocaine into the White House. Andrew Weissman, the hard left would-be killer of Trump who couldn't kill Trump because the Russia thing was a hoax. Andrew Weissman went on MSNBC last night. He said something funny, which is rare. To me, the Secret Service here looks like they can't find a dead cow in a closet. I mean, this is really not a sufficient investigation. Speaker McCarthy talked about this to Martha McCollum, cut number 11.
Bringing the Speaker of the House, Kevin McCarthy. Mr. Speaker, great to have you with us today. So what's your reaction to this? And you hear Jamie Raskin saying, you know, what's a little bit of coke, a little bit of pot, you know, is that not really a big deal? Is that where we are now?
Yeah, I mean, think of this. This is the most secure building probably in America. Just to get into the door before you get through the gate, you go through security. As a member of Congress, when I come with my own security, I still go through security. They have cameras 24/7. It just seems to me when it comes to the Biden Inc. family, they get treated different than anybody else. If they can't tell us first where the cocaine was even located, they gave us three different locations. You know this location right by a situation room. Very few people get to go around there. But if they can't tell us who brought it, what else is happening in the White House they can't tell us?
It's a great question from the Speaker. That's a great question. And I had the Secret Service agent Mark Brandenburg on this week to talk about his very wonderful book, Fence Jumper. And it was a fabulous. Go back and listen to Monday's pod if you want to hear that, or Tuesday's pod. But the fact that this is just stupid, they're doing a cover-up for some staff member or family member. John Kerry, by the way, broke with Joe Biden yesterday. Not that Joe Biden will be aware of it, but John Kerry did. Cut number 10.
The president called Xi Jinping, called him a dictator. Do you believe he wields the power of a dictator today in China? Meaning, is his ability similar to Putin's ability to affect what he says he will do, such that if he makes a promise, he can keep it?
There's no question at all that President Xi is the major decider of the direction and of the policies of
China. Is he in fact effectively a dictator?
Well, I'm not. You know, I don't think it's useful to get into. I'm not going to get into.
But he does wield the power of.
He wields enormous power as the.
You know what I got to tell you? He is a dictator, but I wish Daryl Issa, an old friend of mine, would have said, do you agree with President Biden? Do you agree with President Biden? Why don't you agree with President Biden? You know, there are ways to do this, but members of Congress apparently go, how not to answer ask questions class. Some of them know, like Michael Waltz did it well, but some of them go to, how do I not ask questions class? Time for my relief factor. And why am I doing this? Because I got to go out on the boat. A boat, which is always a dangerous thing for me. Hugh and boats. One hand for the boat, one hand for Hugh. That's sort of taking it from the Patrick O'Brien series and Dr. Maturin. I'm carrying curcumin, resveratrol, and omega. No matter what happens on a boat, I won't be doing a face plant with any lasting injury. I am face plantable, very much face plantable, entering and exiting from boats. But if I do that, I'll be fine because I got my relieffactor.com. Got to get in a 10K in the morning as well, unless it's raining because I don't do it in the rain. Relieffactor.com costs $19.95 for the starter pack. A 500,000 people have said, I'll give that a try. And 7 out of 10 are still using it years later. Why? Because relieffactor.com turns out to work. They feel better. I feel better. You'll feel better because it addresses the minor aches and pains by supplementing your body's natural anti-inflammatory system. Keep the inflammation down, the pain away, and you moving. Keep moving, keep moving, keep moving. The weekend is ahead. Coming right back with Sonny Bunch. Mission Impossible 901 coming up. Welcome back, America. I'm on strike. I'm Hugh Hewitt. I'm a member of SAG-AFTRA, but I don't think Sonny Bunch is, so he's going to be able to talk about Mission Impossible 708. But I can't do anything to do with the movies or TV, Sonny, because I'm on strike. No one asked me. I didn't vote, but I'm on strike. So take it away.
Are you a member of SAG?
Oh, I have been since 1992, yes.
Oh, look at that. So you probably know this then, but do you know the last time SAG and the WGA, the Writers Guild of America, were both on strike at the same time?
Absolutely not. The only time SAG went on strike in the 10 years that I was on television at a SAG-AFTRA-covered studio, PBS in L.A., we voted to cross the picket line, so he went over. So I don't really, and that was in 1996 or so. I don't know when they were last out together.
They were last out together in 1960. 1960. Jeez. So it's been 63 years since both were on strike at the same time. Do you know? All right, trivia. You'll probably be able to figure this out just by the question. But do you know who the president of SAG was at the time?
That would be Ronald Reagan.
Yes, Ronald Reagan. So I assume this means Fran Drescher will soon be our president, which is
what also means I can't I can't perform in Top Gun 3. That's off the table now.
That is off. Assuming it starts filming before, you know.
I hope they settle.
This all gets settled. No, I mean, my other understanding is that the broadcast and news arm of SAG is actually exempt from this.
Are we exempt? See, I didn't even get a vote. It's probably in Virginia, in the Beltway, my vote. And so Fran didn't call me up, but my vote just did not get counted. It was like Democrats were running the election here. Sonny, yeah. So you're going to have to carry the day on Mission Impossible. I haven't seen it. I don't even know if I can talk about it because I'm on strike.
Sure, sure. So the new Mission Impossible is called, a very long title here, Mission Impossible, Dead Reckoning, Part 1. It's part one, so, you know, there's a mild cliffhanger here. So it feels like a full, complete, discrete movie, unlike some other part ones that people weren't necessarily expecting to be part ones. Spider-Man Across the Spider-Verse, Fast X, even Dune a couple years back, right? Those were all kind of surprise part ones for folks. They weren't necessarily expecting this there to be a cliffhanger. This is a part one. It's right there in the title, so I don't want to hear any complaints about incomplete movies. And it is the continuation of the idea of Mission Impossible as a series in which the driving impetus is we are going to watch Tom Cruise do crazy things on screen and try not to die for our entertainment.
Can I correct you for one? This goes to my pre-SAG days, so I don't think it violates my contract. But when I was a freshman in college before you were born, we watched Mission Impossible every night at 11 o'clock in reruns. So Mission Impossible is in my DNA. I think Mission Impossible goes way back before Tom Cruise. If you just want to do the homage to Peter, that would be the appropriate time to do it right now.
Well, that is well. So this is my point. I mean, look, you can even see it in the in the way the series has evolved, right? So this series used to be a very interesting kind of exercise in auteur filmmakers, right? Like the first one, Mission Impossible, is directed by Brian De Palma, and it was very distinctively a Brian De Palma movie, right? Like lots of split diopter shots where you have two things in different parts of the screen, both in focus at the same time, right? That's a thing that Brian De Palma is known for. It was also, you know, kind of sexy, right? Which is another De Palma touch. The second one was directed by John Woo, and again, it was very much a John Woo movie. You know, lots of motorcycle chases and big explosions and slow motion and doves, right? And then the third one is a J.J. Abrams movie. Now, J.J. Abrams wasn't as big a director as either of those two. When he you know, made this movie, but it is still very distinctively a J.J. Abrams movie. If you've seen his work on TV or the Star Trek reboot or Super 8, right, you would be like, oh, yeah, that's a J.J. Abrams movie. And then it shifts. It shifts in the fourth one, which is, I believe, titled Ghost Protocol, from auteurist spy movies where people wear cool masks and there's a convoluted plot to we're going to show Tom Cruise doing crazy big stunts, right?
Like, yeah, so I call this I'm Not 60 Part 7. This is Tom Cruise saying I am not 60 years old Part 7. but go ahead.
Exactly, exactly. No, I mean, this is, he has taken full control of this series. The first one was directed by Brad Bird, but since then, it's been directed and written by Christopher McQuarrie, who he has worked with on a ton of stuff. Valkyrie, Edge of Tomorrow, the Mummy movie he rewrote. I mean, Christopher McQuarrie has been his aide-de-camp for the better part of 15 years now. The whole point of these movies now is, like, we're going to watch Tom Cruise do big, big stunts and do big, dangerous things. So, right, the advertising campaign in Ghost Protocol was all about him hanging off the Burj Khalifa. Remember, yep. the ad campaign for this is just him hanging off the side of this giant building.
And now it's the motorcycle stunt, which we're showing on right. the Salem News Channel right now.
Yeah. So right now it is the whole advertising campaign essentially has been Tom Cruise is jumping off a mountain. And he's going to jump off a mountain and he's going to go into a base jump. And he's going to go into a base jump and he's going to crash into a train. He's going to land on a train. That's the idea of this movie. That's it. That's all there is. And it's very funny, too. If you look at the actual plots of the films, they've become hilariously generic, right? So the fifth movie, what is the plot? The plot is the syndicate, which is comprised of rogue agents, is trying to take down the system. And they need to get the lockbox. Literally, this is the plot. I'm not adding generic terms here. These are terms from the movie that is being used that are used within the movie to describe what is happening. And here it's the AI has been unleashed on the internet.
Oh no. It's an AI movie?
It's an AI movie. So the other thing, speaking of SAG and AI, this is a very much a movie about the dangers of ChatGPT taking over the world and using its evil powers to end it all. I don't know. I mean, I may sound a little dismissive here, but I like this movie a lot. It's a lot of fun. It's like a Fast and the Furious movie, except good. It's coherent. It's got good acting. It's got a real star.
Second, Sonny. I read something this week I wanted to test on my Sonny Bunch Truth-O-Meter, which is Tom Cruise is not the best actor, but he is the biggest movie star alive today. And I thought to myself, having just watched Burn before reading, I might say Brad Pitt is both the best actor and the best movie. If you had to have a combo, what do you think?
I would say that there is nobody on the planet who is more identifiable in his very specific sort of way than Tom Cruise. Tom Cruise is doing, again, he's doing a very specific thing at this point in his career, right? I think it's safe to say he is the biggest, most identifiable star. Your other two options would be Brad Pitt, I think is not a terrible choice. Brad Pitt is a good option here. The other choice would be Leonardo DiCaprio, who, whatever you think about him in his roles, is he's a good award-winning actor, and he also puts butts in seats. He is a consistent box office draw. The real test of this is going to be his new movie with Martin Scorsese, which is a 3.5-hour historical epic.
I have a complaint about Failure to Warn, Sonny Bunch Division. Fetching Mrs. Hugh and I went and saw Indiana Jones. But because the movie was starting at, let's say, noon, we said, okay, we'll show up at 12:20 and we'll catch the movie. It had actually begun. We came in and Harrison Ford was strung up by his neck. And no, who starts a movie on time? And then I remembered it's 2.5 hours long. They probably have to turn it over 4 times, so they're ditching the previews. What's the deal with that?
Where'd you go see it?
String Flagship Cinemas. It's a string up in Maine.
Okay. Yeah, I don't know. Every chain does it slightly differently, right? So, AMC has about 25 minutes of previews.
Yes.
I usually go to the Alamo Draft House, which has 15 minutes of previews. So maybe Flagship just has a different runtime. But you're right. Here's the thing. That movie's a million hours long.
I mean, oh my gosh, it's still going on. How long is Mission Impossible 904?
So this one is also very long, but it doesn't feel long. Okay, so that's a big plus in its favor. I never once was looking at my watch like, whoa, how much time is left? But this one is pretty long. It's 2 hours before credits. It's probably about 2.5 hours long.
All right, we can play the trailer again, Harley. I don't mind watching a trailer forever. The trailer is, by the way, I'm a big trailer fan. This is an excellent trailer.
Great trailer. It's a great trailer. Look, it sells what the movie is actually about, which, again, like, I could maybe explain slightly more about what the plot is to you, hear you. But all you really need to know is AI. But no, really, really the big deal here is stunts. It's stunts. It's Tom Cruise being death-defying, daredevil.
I'm not 60, even though I'm 60. I mean, it just really is, I'm not 60. And it's going to go on for a long time because it's going to make bank, right?
I think so. I mean, it's probably going to open to around $90 to $100 million over its first 5 days. But it'll probably have legs because it is, again, it's like it's getting pretty good.
You know what has legs, Sonny, is Sound of Freedom. I don't know if you've seen Sound of Freedom yet, but Sound of Freedom is actually doing quite well.
Did you go see it, Hugh? I haven't
Not
seen
yet.
It yet.
No, I've been on with Tim Ballard watching previews of it, but I haven't sat down in a theater yet.
Yeah, it's only playing at AMCs near me and not very frequently. So I haven't been able to make it out to see it yet. I hear good things. I mean, look, there's lots of controversy surrounding this movie, you know, Q stuff. But I've heard, you know, good things.
A good movie, and that originally my stomach gets a little bit queasy with child trafficking, but they leave the queasy out, but they make it very, very satisfactory telling of. Tim Ballard's a real guy. He's been on the show a lot, and Operation Rescue is a real thing, and they do go save children, and this is a really good thriller.
Yeah, I mean, again, I haven't seen it, so I can't judge it on that, but I have heard good things, and, you know, it's doing very, very well, it's one of these things where you look at it, you see the success here, you think people should be, you know, picking up what the audience vibes are putting down, but we'll see.
We'll see. Sonny Bunch on Twitter, also across the movie aisle, and the Bulwark goes to the movie. He's got two podcasts a week. He's here every week, the official movie critic of the Hugh Hewitt Show. And although I'm on strike, I'm happy to talk to him. You're not on strike, are you, Sonny? You're not a SAG-AFTRA person.
No, I'm not. I'm not in any unions.
You know what the best thing about SAG-AFTRA was? For years, they would send you CDs of the movies. They don't do that anymore. That's a bummer. No, yeah, that's over. Now they send you a coded...
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Coded thing. Don't go anywhere, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt, SAG-AFTRA member, and I'm on strike.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by PhD Weight Loss and Nutrition. Go to myphdweightloss.com to learn more.
Welcome back, America. Hugh Hewitt here, joined now by the poet laureate of the Hugh Hewitt Show, Tarzana Joe. Hello, Joe. It's a new shirt.
It's a new shirt. And it's a new head.
Oh, you did? You went the whole thing. Is that your effort to match Dwayne on myphdweightloss.com?
It starts with a few ounces off the top, yeah. It's my summer hockey haircut, even though I'm not playing hockey anymore.
What? When did you retire?
Oh, about 4 years ago. I hung up the skates.
Oh, you took a long time to tell me that. I've been telling everyone you're a hockey player up here in Maine, and they're all impressed. Now they're going to revoke their impressiveness.
Still at heart. And you can grant me clemency as keeper of the blue line in Minnesota. Weren't you the keeper of the blue line in Minnesota?
I was. I was right there on the blue line with my rotator cuff. I'm sorry I couldn't join you on the ice and outskate everyone, but I couldn't.
I understand. I have two poems for you today. One, because your producer, if you had one, asked me to weigh in on the great hot dog controversy. And here goes.
Uh-oh.
Last week, a great debate ensured your listeners were thrilled. Are hot dogs better boiled or are they better grilled? But without complete parameters, these things can't be debated. What about convenience stores where hot dogs are rotated? I, for one, prefer my dogs like Secretary Seward. I love my baked Alaska, but I want my hot dogs skewered. That's the final word. Even though the rotating and skewering parts of the party are far concessions.
Did that take you 30 seconds to put together there, Joe?
35, yeah.
Okay, I'm saying that was, I was expecting an epic poem, and that was kind of a hot dog length poem.
Exactly. A couple of bites and you're done. That's good. I like it.
Second poem.
This is another poem. Quick, second poem. The daring mainstream media regards with hesitation stories on the nature of the leader of our nation. It's always been so strange to me his soul goes unassessed, considering we live in times where everyone's undressed. I'll share with you a theory if you want to know my views. They don't promote these stories because none of this is news. The man is swifter to anger. His heart is tough as suet. It isn't worth a headline. We all already knew it. He can't recall a single name. He's quite prone to forgetfulness. He has a massive ego, the size of our indebtedness. He plagiarized some speeches. He bluffed his way through college. But all that isn't fit to print because it's common knowledge. And so I've come to the belief regarding our Joe Biden, if this is what they're printing now, what else must they be hiding? That's Hot Dogs and Joe by Tarzana Joe.
You know what alarms me, Joe?
A few things, I'm sure, but go ahead and tell me.
Well, suet rhymes with Hewitt. Never occurred to me until this poem. You may not use that.
Never again. Never. It's retired.
Suet.
The retired rhymes.
Oh, dear. Well, Joe, you were wrong on the hot dogs, but you were right about Joe. So 1 out of 2, you can bat in the majors.
Yes, thank you very much. I appreciate it. I've always felt that I've been playing in the major leagues.
All of your poetry needs can be met by Joe if you email him at TarzanaJoe@Reagan.com, TarzanaJoe@Reagan.com. And can TarzanaJoe.com handle 2 poems at once?
We'll see. It's been a little dicey, a little crashy, but we'll get them up there.
Right, TarzanaJoe.com for everything you just heard. And if you need one, write to him at TarzanaJoe@Reagan.com. Thank you, Joe.
Thank you, Hugh.
Now, what I want to make sure we all do is also go to HughStrawPoll.com, HughStrawPoll.com. I've told you all week long, all of the Salem media outlets, whether it's Hot Air or Red State or Town Hall or the Hugh Hewitt Show or Mike Gallagher or Dennis Prager, Charlie Kirk, Seb Gorka, Officer Brandon, all of our local affiliates, all of our local hosts, we're all running a something straw poll. Mine is HUGHStrawPoll.com because I said, let's make it easy. You got a big audience in Pittsburgh. Let's just make it HughStrawPoll.com. They're still entering Straw Poll Hugh, and that's not correct. It's HughStrawPoll.com. And we have geolocation services, so we know it's the Pittsburgh people who are screwing it up. HughStrawPoll.com. And tell us of all the people on there. Are you Trump? Are you DeSantis? Are you Scott? Are you Haley? Are you Vivek Ramaswamy? Are you Chris Christie? Are you Vice President Pence? Those are the 7 I think who are going to make the stage. I do not think anyone else is going to make the stage. Not sure about Governor Christie. Not sure. We will see. But I did not want to get out of this hour without bringing you to the best of President Biden's press conference in Finland yesterday. So let's talk first about cut number six, President Biden.
And we're working in lockstep on to tackle climate crisis, which you've been leaders on for a long time. And in order to literally preserve our planet, it's the only existential threat humanity faces. And we don't have
I would say that the Chinese Communist Party is an existential threat if you want to be a human. Then he shorts out. Cut number four.
Frederiksen of Denmark and the Ministry of Cobalt, daughter of Ireland. You can tell that's a Freudian slip. I'm thinking of home. The daughter of Iceland. And I want to say, I think...
Oh, my gosh. Every time. One more. Cut number five to a foreign reporter.
Are you worried that the political instability in U.S. will cause issues in the alliance in the future?
Let me be clear. I didn't say we couldn't guarantee the future. You can't tell me whether you're going to be able to go home tonight. No one can be sure what they're going to do.
It makes no sense, but that's Joe. The rest of the world says, I guess the United States can run on autopilot. And we are running on autopilot. I do not know who's running the country, but it isn't Joe Biden. Stay tuned, America.
This hour of Hugh Hewitt starts right now on Salem News Channel.
Good morning, America. I hope you have a great Friday ahead as we head into high summer. Dr. Larry Arnn at Hillsdale is coming along, hillsdale.edu, somewhere later in the program. We're going to be talking about the Supreme Court and everything that got done and didn't get done and will happen with SCOTUS. Plus all the news of the day, everything you need to know is right here on the Friday edition of The Hugh Hewitt Show.
You won't want to miss a minute. This hour of Hugh Hewitt is on Salem News Channel.
Morning, glory, America. Bonjour, hi, Kennedy Hewitt from Studio North. Thank you for joining me. I'll be on special report tonight. Hope you'll be joining me there. But I am on strike. I'm a member of SAG-AFTRA, and I am on strike. So I don't know what that means for Ben Domenech. Ben, are you a member of SAG-AFTRA? Are you out on strike, too?
No, I am not. In my various tanglings with the NLRB, where I'm still 1-0 in federal appeals court against them. I'm not really the biggest of fans when it comes to this sort of thing. But I do wonder what kind of position does this put you in? Are you allowed to think, Hugh?
I actually don't know, because Fran didn't send me a ballot. I didn't even get to vote on the SAG-AFTRA walkout, and so I don't know what it's sitting around in a post office box somewhere. So I can't make Mission Impossible 904, and I can't be in Top Gun 3 if this happens right now, Ben. But nevertheless, I can press forward, and I want to begin by asking you about Mission Impossible. Are you going to go see it?
I have already seen it. In fact,
what?
I saw it on Tuesday. They had an early release showing on at the wonderful Alamo Theater, which, if you have not partaken of it yet in Crystal City, you definitely should, Hugh. A good friend of mine and I went to the earliest possible showing because I was not going to wait around on this one.
Did you take the baby?
I did not take the baby. The baby has not had her first movie yet. But
you know what I love is parents who bring small children with headphones to theaters. I want them jailed. I want them all jailed.
I completely agree, Hugh. That's not a place for them to be. I got to tell you, I loved it. I thought it was great. I will say that Fallout, just as a the prior Mission Impossible, as a movie, because it is a complete movie. You know, that the part one will tell you that it's a better film just because of that, and because I think the villain involved in Fallout was better. But the subtitle should be great stuff in it.
Sometimes Mission Impossible 700, I'm not 60, Tom Cruise. That's what everyone from now on is, the subtitle to Tom Cruise. I'm not 61, I'm not 62, because it's just so silly. All right, let's get to serious stuff here. Elon Musk is launching an AI company. He's also been over in China telling them that, well, who isn't a socialist? What do you think about that?
You know, I'm very concerned about, the fact of, the matter is that there's so much, praise for Elon from the American right, and I would say from a lot of independent thinkers, who do have a point there. But keep in mind that, if you ask people to list kind of the top companies that are, involved in terms of tied in with the economic interests of China, Apple is certainly number one, but Tesla is really number two in terms of, the amount of work that they get done over there. And I think that should be something that we pay a lot of attention to going forward, particularly given that, from everything that I've been told and everything that I've read, that the advancements that China has made when it comes to AI should not be underestimated.
I agree. And it's an arms race.
I think that we're behind the eight ball on that one.
It's an absolute arms race. I'm kind of glad that Musk is involved. I'm glad Amazon is in there. I'm glad NVIDIA is in there, but because it's an arms race, and it will. I guess Mission Impossible has a AI sub-theme, according to Sonny Bunch.
It certainly does, and they do a pretty good job with it.
War Games did a pretty good job.
Of course, the AI is probably what's keeping Tom Cruise looking that great.
Amen. CGI Tom Cruise. All right, now FDA yesterday approved a birth control pill for over-the-counter. I'm sure this wasn't political at all, Ben. What do you think?
Well, it's kind of everything's happened within that space in ways that seem very counterintuitive. They press forward basically with the ability to get an abortion with, virtually no interaction with the doctor, effectively, a telemedicine thing where you don't even have to go in to get the kind of test. We've already seen the ramifications of that, by the way, in Europe and the UK. Where you had, women during this most recent lockdown and making use of these policies and also lying about how far along they were in order to avoid the law when it comes to the limits they have over there. And yes, they do have limits. Everybody pretends they don't. I think that this is something that I think was going to happen for a long time just because of the ubiquity of the pill. in American life, and the fact that a lot of women, you know, basically think that they shouldn't have to go back to their OB to re-up their prescription and that type of thing. But there are also, you know, negative ramifications of it in the sense that, you know, there's certain people who I think, you know, have really gone against the idea that the pill should be ubiquitous, especially for, you know, for women who have been on it for a very long time. They come out of that process and they find that fertility is a real challenge. And so they wish that they had had those kinds of interactions with doctors to warn them of the negative potential ramifications for them. So, look, you know, I'm not surprised by it. I think that under Joe Biden, what he's going to do is press ahead in every single possible way to, you know, increase access to abortion from his perspective, including, as you've made note of, you know, this battle that's happening about the NDAA and funding directly the travel of women who wanted to, you know, who wanted to get abortions in states where it was not allowed under their current base.
Yeah, I'm going to come to Tommy Tuberville in a second. We may disagree on that. But first, the president was in Finland yesterday. Let me play a clip for you. Cut number four, President Biden in Finland yesterday.
Frederiksen of Denmark and the Minister Jacobo, daughter of Ireland. You can tell that's a Freudian slip. I'm thinking of home. The daughter of Iceland and...
Ben, the president in Finland, I just got to ask you, did you watch Veep when it came out?
Yeah, I absolutely
remember
loved
the
it.
President of Finland in Veep?
Yes. Very, Mina. Very, very charming.
Wouldn't it have been better if he had just met with her?
Yeah. We could have probably gotten away with telling him that it was the president of Finland. Yes. He might not have noticed the difference. In fact, he might have even complimented, "Oh yes, I remember you from the television."
Yeah, you were very good in that docudrama. Okay, now, Tommy Tuberville, I think, is the dumbest man in the United States Senate, and I'm going to say that until he stops holding the American military hostage. I agree with him on the policy, but not promoting anybody in the military from 06 to higher because he wants this change is about the dumbest way. It's like driving to Maine from Vermont via Canada. It's the dumbest thing I've seen. What do you think?
Well, I'll have to voice my my brother, Major Domenech's opinion here and just say that he doesn't give a flying flip about it and, in fact, thinks that, you know, there's no actual operational problem with it. He thinks that everybody's making a tempest out of it because these are the types of individuals who tend to have political connections and tend to be able to play this up. One thing that I think is really interesting about this, though, and I'm thinking of maybe profiling Tuberville. I've written a profile, I hope you've read, of Mark Wayne Mullen. Some of these newer folks who aren't really known quantities yet, I think a lot of people are surprised that he didn't sort of back off this earlier. And it indicates to me that this is something where I think he's gone a little bit rogue in terms of the...
Oh, he's way rogue.
Possible.
But, you know, you got to go back to Major Domenech. He's an 04. And I got an 03 in my family, an 06 in my family. So I got no one involved in this. But they tell me, all these general officers have got families. They're all screwed up on their orders. They're not getting their pay raises, and their billets aren't being filled, or they're being filled on a temporary basis. And it really does have a snake-like effect. And it's got no impact whatsoever on whether or not the NDAA gets out of the House. Now, it's in the abortion ban, or the travel abortion ban is in the NDAA now. Isn't this a good time to declare victory and go home?
I have to say, another example of an area where, you know, people doubted that was going to turn out to be that way, but then the House held together. I mean, these Republicans in the House are just, as much as the mainstream media frames them as being at each other's throats all the time about things, they sure do seem to hold together with great frequency. But, you know, I personally think that, you know, this is something that's going to resolve itself. But one thing that I did find of interest during the whole Tuberville thing was that when he was talking about, you know, it was most recently, you know, I think this is 2 weeks ago, so maybe that's changed, but he made the point that no one in the White House had talked to him. No one in the White House had talked to him. They had not reached out.
That's an echo of Newt Gingrich having to get off Air Force One from the back air step. All right. Well, I got to finish by asking you about the cocaine, Ben, since you're an expert on these things. What do you think? As someone said, if that's an investigation, actually, Andrew Weissman said they couldn't find a dead cow in a closet if that's an investigation.
That was not an investigation. Personally, look, the Hunter Biden sort of aspect of this gets more attention. What I personally think is more likely is that some dumb staffer was out partying the night before and chose to ditch it in that way, as in a way that would be a little less perhaps blatant. But I think that, you know, having used those cubbies, you know, that's something that you use when you're going into a pretty serious meeting. So it's probably a pretty serious person, in other words.
Yeah, and it's on tape. It's on tape somewhere. Every time I've gone past those cubbies, and I always forget to put my phone in, and I always do, after you get told to by the Uniformed Secret Service, it's not being filmed. Ben Domenech of The Spectator and Fox News contributor. Thank you, Ben. Coming right back, America. The lightning round is always fun on Friday with Ben. Stay tuned.
Madam Vice President.
Madam Prime Minister.
I am delighted to welcome you to Finland.
Thank you. And please call me Selina.
Selina?
Yes?
Excuse me?
What?
Shall we begin?
Oh, yes. Yes. Would you like to lead the way?
Yes, yes. Or you like to go first?
Oh,
no,
we can.
No, we can go together.
In tandem? We shall go.
Yes.
I have a gift for you. We hope that when you come to our country, you will go fishing.
Because no one will feed me?
Because you love fishing.
I don't, actually. How baffling. No, but it is still a beautiful gift.
I have to rewatch Mina. Just for Mina. If you have not watched Veep, first of all, it's R-rated. I'm Hugh Hewitt, July 14th, and that was a clip from Veep. Julia Louis-Dreyfus, who is my daughter's very uninspiring commencement speaker 1,000 years ago. But Julia Louis-Dreyfus is very funny in Veep. Now, Veep is, it's been described to me by my son, who's a Beltway creature, and following in his father's footsteps, that if you merge House of Cards with Veep, you've got real DC. Now, I didn't live there from 89 to 2016, so I'm not really a Beltway guy, but I've been back. I've been transplanted, and the transplant took, except I leave as soon as I can, because no one should be there anytime between May and September, period. But it's uninhabitable. I think it's actually where dengue fever started, is in the Beltway. But if you haven't watched Veep and you don't mind adult situations, I think it's the funniest thing television I've watched in the last 10 years. And Mina is one of my favorite characters. At one point, Julia Louis-Dreyfus says, I'd like to introduce you to my good friend, Mina. And she says, yes, we have met twice. And it's just so, if Joe Biden's staff had a lick of sense, any kind of production value, but they can't because they're always afraid he's going to fall over on his face, step on a rake, and say something incredibly dumb. Well, let's give me a for example. Yesterday in Finland, President Biden cut number four.
Frederiksen of Denmark and the Minister Jakobo's daughter of Ireland, daughter of Ireland. You can tell that's a 40th slip. I'm thinking of home. The daughter of Iceland and...
it's not and, home. It's not a Freudian slip. He is incompetent. All right? That's the bottom line. I think anyone we nominate is going to win. I think Donald Trump will beat him. I think Tim Scott will beat him. Nikki Haley will beat him. I believe that Mike Pence will beat him. Chris Christie will beat him. I don't think he's going to be their nominee. I think Vivek Ramaswamy would beat him. Who have I forgotten from the big seven? There are seven who are going to be on the stage, I think. Not that someone else can't come out of nowhere and get the 40,000 donations, but I don't see it happening. Well, if it's seven people, they missed a chance. Maybe we could put Mina on the stage. This is my suggestion to Ronna McDaniel, is put Mina on the stage for, her name is Phillips, I think. I don't know the actress, but it's pretty doggone funny. And if you haven't watched it, do. I don't know who you are supporting for president, which is why we are running the HughStrawPoll.com. Now, it's not just me. Every Salem platform and a lot of our affiliates who are locally owned and operated stations, all my saga. Saga, by the way, is not SAG-AFTRA. Saga is a great radio company, and they are my flagship up north here, WGAN out of Portland, broadcasting across the great wild north, north and south, deep into the interior. It may even reach Canada. I'm trying to free Canada, at least on the eastern edge of Canada. And I just want you all to watch Veep. And I don't know if any of my main gang has watched Veep. My main gang, Brian the banker, Tony the CE guy, commercial real estate guy, and Mark the Digger, Judge the Marine, all these guys. I don't know if they've ever watched Veep, but I'm going to go around and become a Veep apostle. I'm like Johnny Appleseed of Veep. Everybody needs to laugh. Watch that. But you also need to vote in the straw poll. So we're running it across the world of my affiliates and saying, and everybody else. Now, Mike Gallagher's got three or four affiliates, so he'll talk to them, and I've got 480. So I would encourage all of you to get out there. And even if you're a Gallagher fan, Mike is supporting, well, I don't want to tell you who Mike is supporting because it's going to make former President Trump angry if I do. But I am not supporting anyone. I'm in Switzerland. Everybody else can leave Switzerland, not me. I'm in Switzerland. I deal with everybody fairly up front. But I do want to know what the audience thinks. So we're going to get all this data and then we're going to cross-tab it to find out, you know, where's Gallagher's audience versus my audience? And we don't know because Mike attracts the super demo. Mike attacks the people who live in palatial condos on the Gulf of Mexico and in Manhattan. And so his super audience, I mean, they're great P1s, but that's what you got to do. And then we got to find out how they... We may not have a lot of overlap with some of our friends, and we may have complete Venn diagram concurrence. We'll see. But you don't know until you go to HughStrawPoll.com, HughStrawPoll.com. Don't forget as well, if it's Friday, that means it's Relief Factor Double Down Day, because you're going to do something this weekend that you don't normally do, especially since it's the summer. Mostly that means you're going to stay inside and complain about the humidity. Not me. I'm out there on the great, I'm going out on Casco Bay and sailing the Atlantic with my face to the wind, Robert Redford style, in The Way We Were, or he actually made a movie recently about a sailboat that sunk. Maybe I shouldn't bring up Robert Redford. I can't remember that. But I really do think Mina ought to have been in Finland with the president yesterday. He may not have gotten the joke, but the rest of us would have gotten the joke. Don't go anywhere. I'm coming right back. I got to talk with Matt Dolan, running for Senate in Ohio, Dolan for Ohio on Twitter. Matt Dolan is largely responsible for universal school choice coming to Ohio. It may be the better option because it's means tested a little bit, not much. And I want to see how it works in Arizona and how it works in Ohio, because that, there's Mina. We're showing it to you on the Salem News Channel. Gosh, I love Mina. Don't go anywhere, America. If you combine Veep with House of Cards, that's actually the Beltway. Stay tuned.
I can't. Hopefully it's just.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. My guest is State Senator Matt Dolan from the Buckeye State. Good morning, Senator Dolan. Welcome back to the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Good morning, Hugh. Thanks for having me back.
I want to say, the last time you were on, you told me not to worry about the Guardians because Terry Francona's teams always start late. Here we are, after the All-Star break, they're in first place, right?
That's right. That's right. So we should have a fun August, September, and October, and down south they're in first place, too, in Cincinnati. So Ohio's the place for baseball.
It is, and the place for college football. Matt Dolan, you passed, because of your efforts, universal school choice in Ohio. Now, I think it's probably a better option than Doug Ducey's, which is universal, because I believe in means testing for benefits. Tell us about universal school choice, because your mean testing limit, I think, is 450% of as well of the poverty level. Is that right?
That's right. So not only I tell you the Guardians will be okay, I did say, don't worry, we'll get universal choice passed. And what we did is we set a bar at 450% of poverty, which is $135,000 per year for a family of four, that if you're at that or less, you receive a full scholarship, which it looks like will be $8,400 for high school, $6,600 for K through eight. Above $450,000, Hugh, as you said, we're means testing it down to 10%. So no matter what your income level is, you will receive 10% of the scholarship. Now, the reason you want to do that is because we want parents all over the state to decide for themselves where their child should be educated. You know, choice came about because we had some failing public schools. We have great public schools, but we want to make sure that a parent, if they don't like the way that the schools are being taught, that they don't like the education their child is getting, that no matter where you are or what level of income you are, you have the ability to decide for yourselves where the child gets educated. And that's what we're having happen in Ohio. And that's the best way to combat a lot of these teachings that are creeping into school that don't teach the right history, that are indoctrinating kids, is to be able to say, hey, the market's going to say, we're leaving.
Yeah, Senator Dolan, one of the reasons I like this is I think it allowed you to increase the amount of scholarship for the poorest people. And the rich folks who are sending their kids to private schools anyway, they get a little bit. But you know, that's not why they're going to be able to do it. I went to Catholic school for 12 years. My parents paid that check and they never thought twice. But poor kids can't do that. The option's not there. Is that why? Were you able to fully fund poor kids by means testing the higher level?
Yeah, I mean, that's some of the budget decisions you make. But also, you know, when you look in deeper, Hugh, you'll see that the private schools cannot charge additional tuition for any family that's at 200% of poverty or less. So that scholarship will open the doors to many schools. And the schools can't say, well, that's great, but we need another $8,000 on top of that. This will allow, you know, folks who are financially struggling and want to improve their lot in life, this will allow them the ability to go to any school they choose to want to go to.
Last question on this, Senator Dolan. Again, it's a big win. Aaron Bear called me up and told me, thank Matt Dolan for getting this done. Congratulations. Your sister Joan and I are friends. She's deeply involved in the Catholic school. Have they begun to see it yet? Because you've got a control group with your sister, right? So I don't want to mention her school, but you're going to be able to know. Is it going to work right away?
Well, yeah, yes. And, you know, her school and my brother-in-law's school is actually a little bit different even, and they have access. But, yeah, they are seeing a bump in enrollment from kids who otherwise would not be able to go there. So, yes.
Now,
so
let's switch to the Senate
race. We want to address.
First of all, what is the website for your race for the United States Senate against Sherrod Brown?
Dolan for Ohio. That's Dolan, F-O-R, Ohio. We'd welcome anybody to come on board, see all my what I stand for, what I've accomplished, and I'd love your help to beat Sherrod Brown.
Now, I've got a request in, and we'll have Frank LaRosa on next week, so I think he's going to declare. So it's going to be you, Bernie Marino, and Frank LaRosa. What's going to define that race? Who can beat Sherrod Brown? That's what, if I'm a conservative in Ohio, I want to nominate the most conservative person who can beat Sherrod Brown. That's my test. Is that you? And if so, why?
The answer is yes, and that's exactly how I am running my campaign, irrespective of who's in or who's out. is, look, you know, I have a record of achievement both in the private sector and the public sector. I started my career as a prosecutor fighting, you know, crime with law and with law enforcement. I have success in the private sector. And what I've been able to accomplish in the public sector is take conservative principles and ideals that we all believe in and actually get them into law. We talked about choice, tax cuts. You know, when I got to Ohio, there were over 7%. When I got to Ohio legislature, there was over 7%. We're now down to 3.5%. We had 9 brackets. We're down to 2. We've cut regulations. We took the Trump 2-for-1 and we put it in Ohio. And every day we fight to keep that in there. These are the things that I've executed on. And I want to take to Washington. I can beat Sherrod Brown. I come from the part of the state that Sherrod Brown comes from. I am going to cut right into his supporters. This race, Hugh, is going to be won by the Republican who can present a conservative ideas and agenda that appeals to independent voters. And to say when Republicans who want to act get in charge, good things happen. I'm that guy. I'm the one that Sherrod Brown is most concerned about running against. There was an independent poll just came out a few weeks ago that said I am the biggest threat to Sherrod Brown. It shows me statistically tied with everyone else in the Republican primary. So we are situated really well, and I'm not worried about who else is in. I know that my story, my success, will be the biggest threat to Sherrod Brown, but equally as important, Hugh, when we get to Washington, we can get things done.
Now, Senator Dolan, if I come to Ohio and do a couple of debates, will you sit down with Bernie and Frank with me and do a roundtable? Because those are the three guys.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're very good at debating. Bernie said yes, too. I haven't met Frank LaRosa yet, so I don't know what he's going to say. Let me go back to below the surface politics. What you almost said is the Republican who can take votes away from a Democrat in Cuyahoga County wins. That also applies to urban Youngstown and Warren and northeastern Ohio, Toledo, Dayton, Columbus. Why do you think you can do better in Cuyahoga County than anybody else against Sherrod Brown in the general?
Well, I've already proven that. You know, I've run in Cuyahoga County and I've outperformed President Trump by 11 points, which means that independent votes. See, this isn't about Democratic votes. You know, I may appeal to some Democratic votes. My opponents might appeal. But I don't need a single Democratic vote to win this election. The election's going to be won in November by getting independent votes to recognize that Sherrod Brown is one of the most liberal senators in the Senate and does not reflect the values and principles and direction of the state and the country that most Ohioans want to go to. I can go right to Cuyahoga County, Hamilton County, Trumbull County, Mahoning County, Hamilton County, and bring that message of, look what I have done. Look at my conservative results. Look how it's helped Ohio. Look how Ohio is growing, a lot of because of what I was able to accomplish. That's the same thing I want to bring to Washington. You know, I cut taxes. Sherrod Brown has raised taxes. I support the police. I've worked with the police. He wants to defund the police. I am strong on the border. You can't have a country without strong borders. Sherrod Brown doesn't even want to recognize the problem even exists. These are things that I've been able to do and want to do that when I take my message directly to the independent voter, they'll see a Republican who's conservative, who gets things done.
Yeah, I didn't know you were a prosecutor, Matt Dolan. Where'd you go to law school? Are you a case guy or are you a Michigan law guy like Rob Portman?
Yep.
You're a case guy. Okay. Yeah, how long did you prosecute for?
I started my career as assistant attorney general. I don't know if you remember Operation Crackdown. Some of your folks in northeastern Ohio will be. I rode with the police, and we shut down drug houses in the city of Cleveland, and then was able to try murder cases and rape cases and stand shoulder to shoulder with law enforcement. It matters. It matters. People want to feel that they understand their neighborhood security, and I can bring that.
Now, this is out of, you know, I never tell my guests the question, so this is out of left field. I had Leader McConnell on yesterday, and we spent half the time talking about name, image, and likeness. Because the last time I met with all of the Republican conference, we talked about name, image, and likeness for 45 minutes of the hour. Because these senators don't know what to do. Ohio has an NIL law that apparently is working. Why is that?
Well, I mean, I don't know that it's working because the private sector is allowed now to support these athletes who bring a lot of money into these universities. And the private sector, if you make a relationship with the private sector now, you can earn some money while you're going to school. So it works. look, one of the things that, and I struggled with that, Bill, because one of the things I wanted to have, I think the universities need to participate. And these kids, they work hard, they spend a lot of time, and they bring a lot of money in. You know, I'm glad the private sector can weigh in, but I think the universities need to have some skin in the game and help these students as well, because they are working full time as well as getting their degree.
So I had all these senators there, and from the most conservative to the most liberal Republican, they said we can't get anything done because there are too many different points of view. Is that something you think the federal government ought to get involved in, State Senator Matt Dolan, on name, image, and likeness, so that there's one set of rules across the country, or should we leave it to the states?
Oh, I think you should leave those to the states, or make sure that the controlling entity of that organization, which is still the NCAA, that they do it in a fair manner. But look, when I travel the state, Hugh, that's not what I'm hearing about. I'm hearing about the cost of groceries. I'm hearing about filling up your gas tank, that we're not energy independent, that we're weak in the world. So it is a little frustrating to hear that when you get senators together, that's what they're talking about. We need to focus on the issues that are going to improve Ohioans' lives, and that's what I do. And look, when I get to Washington, you know, I have a history. You can look to see I bring people together. We just passed universal school choice. It wasn't easy. We had to fight Republicans as well as Democrats to get that done. That's what I bring to the case. You know, you can go to Washington and get things done if you're willing to work, if you're willing to roll up your sleeves. And I have a record of doing that, and that's what I want to do.
Last question on the budget that passed. Did it do tax relief? I know it was, you got a surplus in Ohio. Mike DeWine is keeping smartly a rainy day fund. But did you do any tax relief anywhere?
How about $3 billion worth of tax relief? It's the biggest tax cut in Ohio history since the last budget I did, which at that point was the biggest tax cut in Ohio history. So yeah, we're very much returning money back to the taxpayers. At the same time, we're balancing our budget with prudent investments as well, universal school choice, mental health, law enforcement. We are doing things that improve Ohioans' lives each and every day.
Dolan, forohio.com, dolanforohio.com. Thank you, Senator. Keep coming back. I'll see you around a debate table with Frank and Bernie, I hope, in the near future. Don't go anywhere, America. Coming right back with Sarah Bedford.
Thanks, you.
The Hugh Hewitt Show is now available on TV. Go to salemnewschannel.com or download the app. You can also watch on Roku and Fire Stick. Salem News Channel, the antidote to the mainstream media.
Welcome back, America. Sarah C. Bedford joins me most Fridays to review the week that was in Congress. But Sarah, you got a big vote today. The NDAA is going to make it to the floor of the National Defense Authorization Act. It's got aid to Ukraine in it. It's also got a rider that bans the Biden administration abortion policy for uniformed military. Is it going to pass?
I think it's going to be really difficult because you have Democratic leadership coming out and saying, don't vote for this because of, like you mentioned, the abortion policy, the limiting of federal funds for transgender care for troops, for their families, the limiting of some DEI training that is paid for by federal dollars. So there's a lot of stuff in there that Democrats don't like. But then you also have Republicans like Marjorie Taylor Greene who are coming out and saying they're not going to vote for it because funding for Ukraine is left in the NDAA. And there are conservatives who don't approve of that. So it's hard to see where McCarthy's going to find, you know, the five or so votes that he needs to get this over the finish line.
Is Marjorie Taylor Greene pro-abortion?
Definitely not. She's not.
Okay, so I do not know how anyone who calls themselves pro-life votes against this because it solves the problem. It will go to conference. Tommy Tuberville can get out of the holy dug for himself and stop holding up uniformed military career people promotion, and it will go to conference if they vote for this. So they got the vote they wanted on Ukraine aid. They lost overwhelmingly, right?
Yes. That wasn't a really close one.
It wasn't close. I mean, the Republicans overwhelmingly favor aid to Ukraine. So do the Democrats. So they got the abortion. They got the ban on DEI. I'm not quite sure how the DEI ban works. What's in that, Sarah Bedford?
There was a more strongly worded one that Matt Gaetz, an amendment that Matt Gaetz tried to attach to the NDA that got voted down. The one that did go through, I believe, just limits some of the training for DEI, de-emphasizes it, and the federal funds that go out for contracting with third parties, for example, to provide DEI training, but it doesn't totally gut every part of the Pentagon's efforts. It's interesting. I was reading the Washington Post coverage of this morning, and they quoted, I don't know, four or five Democrats' arguments before they even got to a single Republican voicing concerns about the NDAA, but a lot of the Democrats were saying, you know, this is a Republicans' war on diversity. They don't care about, you know, including people of color in the military. I don't think that's really what the amendment language says. Republicans just don't want federal funds going towards liberal-leaning training.
Well, it can be unconstitutional if they do, but that's for the courts. Sarah, what I don't understand is I read all the coverage of the vote coming up today. It was my understanding from Congressman Roy and others' public statements that if the Republican Freedom Caucus types got the votes on their amendments, they would support the final bill. And so you're telling me Marjorie Taylor Greene has broke that deal. Are there four others to break it? I don't know how many Democrats are going to vote against the national defense. I really don't. That's a tough vote.
There might be some Republicans that cross the line, and, you know, there are some undecided. Still, Thomas Massie, for example, has come out and said, even though he's voted against NDAA every year, he said, for I think like 10 years, he's an undecided now because of all of the priorities that Republicans were able to get into the NDAA. So there's still a chance. And from McCarthy's standpoint, I don't think that he really could afford another disaster from the conservatives' perspective, like the debt ceiling deal, even though that really was the best deal he could have gotten from Biden. That sort of shook the relationship a little bit between McCarthy and the Freedom Caucus. I think he really needed to shore up trust with them again by allowing them to vote on all of these amendments and get some of them in the NDAA, even if it imperils its passage on this first try.
So they did get what they asked for, votes on amendments. They lost those votes, and now if they shoot this bill down, they are voting against the national defense. I just don't see them doing that. But I go to the Democrats, though. Democrats are really going to vote against the NDAA on the floor. I know what Hakeem Jeffries said. I know that there's some abortion absolutists. But are they really going to put abortion rights for the military to travel ahead of the national defense, Sarah?
That is going to be one of the most interesting things, I think, about the vote today, because as you mentioned, you know, the argument now that Republicans can make right back at Democrats is that to vote against the entire National Defense Authorization bill just because it won't pay for service members to cross state lines to get abortions. It's a policy, honestly, that really affects a very small number of troops in a handful of states. And, you know, to discard the whole bill because that's in it, I think is going to make Democrats look bad, so that you could have some moderate Democrats in battleground seats who still vote for the NDAA because of that.
I think any Democrat who votes against this is asking to get to lose their seat in a tough election year. Last question. Christopher Wray got beat up pretty badly, Sarah. I mean, really badly. Is he going to show up again ever? Because, I mean, there's no answers for these questions after the cocaine non-investigation.
Yeah, you know, I think what we saw there was his sort of a bureaucrat, right? He came across really very much like a company man, just following the FBI handbook to the letter of what he could and couldn't say, which made him look not transparent at all. It wasn't a good look, but at the same time, I'm not sure that any Republican really laid a glove on him in terms of making him look bad or tripping him up. He I think, frustrated a lot of Republicans by how
I have to disagree on that. I think if you talk on robotically about what you can and cannot answer, you lose. Sarah C. Bedford on Twitter. Good to see you, Sarah, with the Washington Examiner. I will see you again soon. Don't go anywhere, America. I'll be right back with Dr. Larry Arnn. Hillsdale.edu for all things Hillsdale. We're back into Churchill, and boy, it's like reading about tomorrow when you're reading about yesterday in Churchill. Stay tuned. Dr. Arnn is next with the Hillsdale Dialogue.